وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today I want to speak about the studying and the practical ways or the methodology that a person can take in studying al-madhhab al-shafi'i. Nowadays what you hear a lot of people say is fulanun so-and-so yahfadu madhhab al-shafi'iyyah, so-and-so is memorized the madhhab al-shafi'iyyah. Or you hear somebody say fulanun shafi'iyyun, so-and-so is a shafi'i. We have to really understand the difference between a person who knows al-furu' al-fiqhiyyah al-madhhab. This person has studied furu', sub-branches of the madhab. And we'll speak about what it means, furu' al-fiqhiyyah. What it means, we'll study that. But that person has just studied al-furu' al-fiqhiyyah in the madhab. He or she hasn't really studied the madhab as it should be. As the scholars would say, قَدْ اخْتَلَطَ بِعَظْمِهِ وَدَمِهِ قَدْ اخْتَلَطَ بِلَحْمِهِ وَدَمِهِ. That this knowledge, this madhab has mixed with his skin and his flesh. That is a person you can truly say is shafi'iyun haqqa, or you can say, if you wish, sahibu nafas in shafi'i. So has a real understanding of madhab al-imam al-shafi'i. Is somebody who the madhab has become mixed with his flesh and his blood. So if studying furu' al-fiqhiyyah doesn't really make you a grounded, knowledgeable person in the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i, then what is it that makes you a person who can be said about him or her, fulanun yahfadu madhab al-Shafi'i, or so-and-so fulanun shafi'i? It's when the person, he studies and he masters 10 sciences ala tariqati ahli al-madhab, but he does it in accordance to the scholars and the people of this particular madhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i. You have to study 10 sciences. And those 10 sciences, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to outline for you what books that you need to study, and we'll discuss a bit of those books and how you need to study those books and etc. These 10 different sciences, you study them ala tariqati, in the way that the scholars of the madhab studied it. And you also study these 10 sciences in the books of the madhab, not from other books, not from other madhahibs, but you study it in what? You study it in the madhab, the books that are taken from within the madhab. Let me touch on those sciences and mention what they are. The first one is usul al-fiqh. The first one is usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh, when you study it, it gives you two benefits. There are many more benefits that it gives you that Imam al-Shatibi mentions, rahimahullah ta'ala, and Imam al-Qarafi mentions, and other great scholars mention. But I'm just going to restrict it to two, which is that it gives you al-malakatu istinbatiyya. When you study usul al-fiqh, it gives you the ability to extract rulings from the evidences, the Quran and the Sunnah. And it also, what does it do? وَتُعَلِّمُهُمْ بِمَآخِذِ الْأَحْكَامِ. You'll also learn where the rulings were taken from. When the scholars, they say this, and the other group of scholars, they say this, you would actually know and understand where they took their ruling from. And you'd be able to understand the discussions and the dialogue that is taking place between the great scholars, because you study the science called usul al-fiqh. And usul al-fiqh, in summary, it's a science in which a person learns three main things. So the first one is ma'rifatu adillati al-ijmaliyya wa kayfiyatu al-istifadati minha wa halu al-mustafid. Three things a person learns in usul al-fiqh. He learns the comprehensive evidences, number one. The second thing that the person learns is how to benefit from the evidence, the dalalat al-alfaz, which a person can study more if they go to the explanation that we put on al-waraqat and risalat al-latifa and other places. And the third one is وحال المستفيد, the mujtahid and the mufti and the qadi and the shurut al-mufti and the shurut al-mustafti and etc. Those are the three main things that usul al-fiqh deal with. So the first science that a person needs to master if he wants to become a true student of madhab al-imam al-shafi'i is that they study usul al-fiqh. And inshallah ta'ala I'll speak about what books that they need to take. The second science is furu' al-fiqhiyya. Furu' al-fiqhiyya is, it's also a science, or it's also a knowledge in which the person learns ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya, al-tafsiliyya. It's a person learns ma'rifatul ahkam al-shar'iyya. The person learns the jurisprudent rulings al-mustamadda, that is rooted from, that is taken from al-mustamadda min ahkam min adilla al-tafsiliyya, which is taken from the adilla al-tafsiliyya. That is where it's taken from. And adilla tafsiriyya is what makes it different from usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh deals with adilla ijmaliyya, comprehensive evidences. Whereas furu' al-fiqhiyya deals with adilla tafsiriyya, detailed evidences. So fiqh is al-ilmu bil-ahkam al-shar'iyya, al-far'iyya, al-amaliyya, al-mustamaddah min al-adilla tafsiriyya. And usul al-fiqh, we said, is what? Usul al-fiqh is al-ilmu bil-adillati al-shar'iyya, which then deals with three points, which is adillatul ijmaliyya, which I just mentioned, and kayfiyatul istifadati minha wa halul mustafid. I don't want to go into that too much because that's not what we're here to talk about. So the second science that the person studies is furu' al-fiqhiyya ala madhhab al-imam al-shafi'i. And many people, this is the only one that they study, and then they think that they've truly understood madhab al-imam al-shafi'i, or that they have become, or they have the rights to be called sahibu nafas shafi'i. So-and-so is grounded and he's mastered the madhab of al-imam al-shafi'i, when the truth is that they haven't. And I believe this can be said about all of the other madhahibs. It can be said about madhab al-imam Malik, madhab al-imam Abi Hanifa, madhab al-imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and madhab al-imam Malik, Shafi'i and Malik, and all of them, it can be said about them. But because we studied the madhab al-imam Shafi'i, and since we're talking about the madhab al-imam Shafi'i, we'll just restrict it to that for now. The third science that the person needs to know so he can be grounded in madhab al-imam Shafi'i is qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Qawa'id al-fiqhiyya is important that the person learns it. By studying al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, all of the sub-branches, shatat, kathir, so many sub-branches that are scattered all over the place, you won't be able to bring them together unless you study qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, because the furu', the sub-branches are too much, and the lifespan of yours is very short. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَعْمَارُ أُمَّتِي مَا بَيْنَ السِّتِينَ وَسَبْعِينَ وَقَلِيلٌ مَنْ يَجُوزُ ذَلِكَ, that the lifespan of my ummah is between 60 and 70, and little go over it. So you most likely are not going to live after 70. And this furu' al-fiqhiyya is too much. You won't be able to master every fara' and have detailed understanding of it. So the way to do it is by studying al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, it gives you malakatul istiqra'iyya. It gives you the ability to have a principle, and whenever a far' comes up or a sub-branch appears or something, an incident happens, you've always got a principle in which you can bring it back to. The fourth is, the person needs to study, is furuq. Furuq al-fiqhiyya. So we've mentioned usul al-fiqh. We mentioned al-furuq al-fiqhiyya. We also mentioned al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Now we're mentioning furuq fiqhiyya. Furuq fiqhiyya means the differences between the furuq that you studied. Sometimes you see an incident or you see a fara' which seems to be similar to a particular one. What is the difference? You need to know the difference, one from the other. And scholars have written books in that. We're going to see, inshallah ta'ala, ala madhab al-imam al-shafi'i, we'll see the books that are written in it. So you study the furuqa, the differences between the furu' al-fiqhiyya that you studied. So what's the difference between this issue from this issue? Okay, because knowing the differences will allow you to give each one the appropriate evidence. But if everything is the same to you, the rulings that you give and the evidences that you come out with will be wrong. The fifth one is istilahat. You have to study the terminologies that is used within the madhab. Here, the person studies tariq al-madhab, the history of the madhab, and the tatawwur, the formation and development that the madhab went through. Also, the person studies the most prominent individuals within the madhab. Okay, and the person also studies the who within the madhab are, for example, the muhaqqiqin of that madhab. Who are the people who we can say they have done tahqiq within the madhab? Every madhab has their ones. We'll see that inshallah ta'ala in madhab al-Shafi'i. Number six is, and the person should study it, is takhrij al-furu'i ala al-usul. Takhrij al-furu'i ala al-usul means, or what it does for you is, it connects asl al-madhab, the foundation of the madhab, to the sub-branch that you took. It connects the two, the asl of the madhab, and it will connect it to the fara', the sub-branch that's out there. That is important that you study that. Number seven is jadal. Jadal is knowing to respond and defend the views and the opinions within the madhab. So the person learns iqamatul hujjah wa raddi shubah, how to establish the evidences and how to also reject the doubts that have been brought forward. Just that's what jadal benefits you, and it teaches you that. Number eight is khilaf. Khilafiyat is the eighth one. Khilaf is what is today known as fiqh al-muqarana. Khilaf is, according to the ulama al-mutaqaddimin, the early generation, the great scholars, when they wrote their books, they called it khilafiyat, like al-imam al-bayhaqi and others. The khilaf means what we call today, or what is called in universities, is fiqh al-muqarana. Fiqh al-muqarana, which is known as comparative fiqh. Khilafiyat is the same. It's comparative fiqh. Now you're comparing the madhab with other madhahibs. You're comparing the madhab, what they hold according to a particular issue, and what the other madhahibs hold. And you compare the views. You need to read that as well. And books that have spoken about those, we'll speak about soon, inshallah ta'ala. Number nine is ifta' wa tanzeel. The madhabs, they have fatawat, verdicts that they've given in issues. Fatawa, verdicts that they've passed. You need to read the books that are written on that and how they applied it on a particular issue. And this will give you great understanding. So reading the fatwa books written by the scholars of the madhab, and we'll mention them, inshallah ta'ala, some of them, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. And how they then placed those fatwas on the particular issues. How they did that. It's very important that you also read books of the madhab in that. Number 10 is tabaqat. Tabaqat is the levels. And this, reading kutub al-tabaqat, the levels of the madhabs and the levels of the scholars of the madhabs, is very important. It's actually what the scholars, they call it, ruh al-madhab. This is actually what gives life to the madhab. And we'll talk about that, inshallah ta'ala. We'll talk about that in more details, inshallah ta'ala. So the way that I plan, inshallah ta'ala, to explain these 10 different sciences that a person needs to know in order to master the madhab is in the following way. The person has to follow, the student has to follow two particular programs, two particular approaches, two particular ways. The first one is dirasa. He has to study these books. He has to study books in each and every one of those 10. He has to study a book or two. And I'm going to mention more than that, inshallah ta'ala. Also, the person has to have mutala'a. The person has to read. Has to have time which they give to reading books written by al-ashab, the people of this madhab. So you have your own private reading. So what I'm going to do, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention the books that need to be studied and taken from a shaykh. And I'm also going to mention the books that a person needs to study and read. The books that the person needs to read alone. Okay? I'll mention those inshallah ta'ala. The first one is the barnamaj al-dirasa. The program of studying and learning will start with usul al-fiqh. The first marhala, the first level, if you want to master the madhab, is that you study the kitab al-waraqat with the sharah of Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. You take the sharah of al-waraqat by al-Mahalli. Mahalli, his sharah of al-waraqat is the best, and he's an imam in the madhab. Okay, he's a great imam, Shafi'i scholar. He has a sharah on al-waraqat, which is called al-tahqiqat. The student, he studies that. And the scholars, they have placed hawashi on it. And there are two hawashi that are on it that are a bit hard. And there are two which I'm going to mention which are simple and easy. The hashiya, which is, or the two hashiya which have been placed on the mahalli that are complicated and that are hard, is the one written by Al-Jawi wrote. Jawi, Ahmad ibn Khatib al-Jawi, rahimahullah, I think his name is. He has a hashir on the sharh of al-Mahalli. Also, Ibn Qasim al-Abadi, he has a sharh al-Kabir and also a sharh al-Saghir, which is a hashir for Mahalli's sharh of al-Waraqat. But those two are very hard. For a person to benefit from it, he has to have tamakkun fi ilm al-mantiq. The person has to have studied ilm al-mantiq. He has to have studied some, at least he should have studied the Akhdari's kitab, Sulam al-Murawraq, in order to have some understanding of Ibn al-Qasim al-Abadi and al-Jawi's Hawashi on the sharh of Mahalli. But an easier hashiya that is being placed on the sharh of Jalaluddin al-Mahalli is the hashiya of Dimyati. And the second one, this is easier. Hashiya of Dimyati is easier. And also the hashiya of Qalyubi. Both of them are also a hawashi placed on the sharh of Jalaluddin al-Mahalli on al-Waraqat. The first two that I mentioned, which is al-Jawi, rahimahullah, and also Ibn Qasim al-Abadi, their sharh is a bit hard, and for you to benefit from it, you would have to have tamakkun fi ilm al-mantiq. Lakin Dimyati's hashiya, and also Qalyubi's hashiya, you can benefit from it. As for the hashiya of Dimyati, it's matbu', it's published, I've seen it. Like, I haven't come across the publication, whether it's published or not, I don't know, of the hashiya of Qalyubi. I'm not 100% sure on that one. So if you can go and find, inshallah ta'ala. That is very good. Should a person go and look at other shuruh at this particular level, at this level, should they look at other explanations of al-waraqat, or should they just stick with mahalli sharh of al-waraqat? I would advise the person to stick with the sharh of Al-Mahalli, because it's very, very beneficial. And it's very easy. And Mahalli, rahimahullah, he also has the ability to extract so much benefit out of the book. But if a person wants to look at other shuruh of Al-Waraqat at this particular level, then I would say if you want, you can look at Al-Imam Al-Kamiliyya Sharah or the Sharah of Ibn Al-Farkah. Like it's better, as I said, to just stick with Sharh Al-Mahalli Al-Waraqat. That's the first level. Okay? And the hours that it should take you to study the Sharh of Al-Mahalli Al-Waraqat, it should be 30 hours, inshallah. It shouldn't exceed 30 hours. The second level of Usul al-Fiqh. So if first level, you've taken the Sharh of Jalaluddin al-Mahalli on al-Waraqat. You finished that. And the best tab'a for Sharh of Mahalli, the best tab'a, the best publication is Darul Nafa'is. Darul Nafa'is, they published it in one volume. That is the best one I've seen. Unless something came out recently. The second level of Usul al-Fiqh, the scholars, they dispute on two books. The first one is Al-Lum'a, written by Ishaq ibn Ibrahim al-Shirazi, rahimahullah ta'ala. Or the Ghayatul Wusul ila Sharhi Lubb al-Usul by Abi Zakariya al-Ansari, Shaykh al-Islam Zakariya al-Ansari, rahimahullah. There's a khilaf amongst the scholars. At this level, should a student of the madhab, should he take Al-Lum'a by Abi Ishaq Ibrahim al-Shirazi, or should he take the Sharh of, or should he take the Ghayatul Wusul ila Sharh Lubb al-Usul by Shaykh al-Islam Zakariya al-Ansari rahimahullah? Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he praised the kitab Al-Lum'a li Abi Ishaq Ibn Ibrahim al-Shirazi. He praised it greatly. And he said that Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, he really hasn't taken the Tariqatul Mutakallimin Usul al-Fiqh. His book, as you would know or you should know, is that Kutub Usul al-Fiqh at the later stages, it started to become tainted with what is known as Ilmul Kalam. They started to emerge with Usul al-Fiqh Ilmul Kalam, which you don't tend to find in the early books of Usul al-Fiqh, like Al-Risala by Imam al-Shafi'i, with the riwayah of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, or the Kitab al-Faqih wal-Mutafaqih by Khatib al-Baghdadi. Those great scholars, they wrote Usul al-Fiqh based on Adilla, Kitab al-Sunnah. But then what came after that, you tend to find that they mixed it up with Ilm al-Kalam. And like the Mustasfa of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali and other books like that. ولذلك, it forced Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi rahimahullah, when he read and he stood over the Kitab al-Mustasfa by Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, it forced him to take out so much things and summarize it and organize it and write it differently to the way that Abu Hamid al-Ghazali wrote it. And he called it Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Munadir, which he took out of it the Ilm al-Kalam that was in it from al-Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. Like in Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi's Kitab al-Lum'a, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah praised it. Also, the Ghayat al-Wusul ila Sharh Lubb al-Usul, the author, Zakariya al-Ansari, his words and the way he talks, it's actually very complicated for a student to understand it. His kalam is full of al-ghaz and full of lughs. It's a lot of times it seems like it's riddles. Not to mention that the Kitab Aslan, the Lubb al-Usul Aslan, was taken from or summarized from the Jam'u al-Jawami' by Tajuddin al-Sukki. And Jam'u al-Jawami' by Tajuddin al-Sukki, as Tajuddin al-Sukki mentioned, he took the Jam'u al-Jawami' from a hundred different Usul al-Fiqh books. So Jam'u al-Jawami' is a summary of 100 books of Usul al-Fiqh. And then what did Tajuddin al-Subki, when he wrote his kitab, Jam' al-Jawami', by the way, when he wrote it, he said that no individual can come after and summarize this book. Because he said, under every letter of this book, it signifies information that you cannot drop a word out of it, let alone, you cannot drop a letter out of it, let alone a word. So زكريا الأنصاري رحمه الله شيخ الإسلام زكريا الأنصاري, he went forward to that challenge. He said, okay, let me try. And he tried to summarize جمع الجوامع by Taj al-Din al-Sukki, and he called it لب الأصول. And to be honest, what he summarized, he got rid of vital information that were needed. So the scholars, they said that his summary wasn't as he wanted to fulfill, but rather he dropped out information that was vital. And then what he did was when he wrote لب الأصول, he felt the need to explain it. He felt the need to explain it, and he then explained it, rahimahullah ta'ala. And his explanation is very good. I personally believe that if you have the strength and the malaka, and you're mashallah very enthusiastic and constituous, and you're a person who's dedicated and aspirations are very high, then I would definitely tell you to go for the Ghayatul Usul ila sharh lub al usul by Zakariya al Ansari rahimahullah. But if you don't have that, then stick with the Lum'a by Imam al-Ishaq al-Shirazi rahimahullah ta'ala. That's the second level. The third level that we come to is after the person has done the first level of studying sharh al-waraqat by who? Mahalli, Jalal al-Din al-Mahalli. And then the second level the person studied, in there they studied either al-Lum'a by Ishaq al-Shirazi or the Ghayat al-Usul ila sharh lub al-Usul by Zakariya al-Ansari. The person moves on to the third level. The third level, the person, they take the Kitab al-Badr al-Tali' fi halli jam' al-Jawami'. This Kitab al-Badr al-Tali' fi halli jam' al-Jawami' is written by Jalaluddin al-Mahalli. There is another sharah like this with this name, with this exact name, which is known as al-Badr al-Tali' fi halli jam' al-Jawami', with the same name, written by Khatib al-Shirbini rahimahullah. Lakin, when I compared the two and I looked at the two, it seems that the Badr al-Tali' fi halli jam' al-Jawami' by Jalaluddin al-Mahalli is better. And I don't want to go into the reasons right now, but this is better. And it has a publication which is actually very, very good, that a student of knowledge can buy. And this is the Taba' of Mu'assasat al-Risala with the Tahqiq of Murtada Dagestan. Murtada Dagestani is from Dagestan. He did Tahqiq of the Kitab, and it's very good. If you buy it with that publication, you'll benefit inshallah ta'ala. The best hashiya that was placed on the Al-Badr al-Tali fi halli jam' al-Jawami' by Jaluddin al-Mahalli is the hashiya of Al-Attar. Like, again, hashiya Al-Attar, it needs a person to have tamakkun. He has to be grounded in ilm al-mantiq, and he has to be grounded in ilm al-kalam. So that's not very good. Also, that sharah is a bit hard. I mean, that hashiya is a bit hard. Hashiya of Al-Attar. The hashiya to Al-Attar is actually very complicated, and it's hard for a student to truly understand it. So it's best that the person goes and he reads the hashiya of Al-Bannani. Bannani's hashiya, Al-Alamat Al-Bannani, is actually better and easier. And in nahit tahqiq and tadqiq, he's actually of great benefit in that regard, and it's easier for a person to understand. Here now, once the person has done those three levels in usul al-fiqh ala madhab al-imam al-shafi'i, what's now open for you is al-mutala. You've done the first part, which is dirasa. You studied it with a teacher. A teacher taught you those books. He went through with you. Now what's open for you is to read them. What you study is four ummahat books. And I'm going to mention all of those levels of those ummahat, which you need to read by yourself. You just need to do mutala'a, hurra. You sit, you organize your time, and you start reading them. And you extract benefits from them. And when you're reading them, you buy a notebook. You get a pen, and you take these books, and you try to summarize it. Number two is you try to rewrite the content page for your own self. Once you've done that, you summarize those books, and you've written the content page for it, then you could say that I've understood this book. And I'm going to mention these ummahat in four levels. The first level, the person should try to read al-risala by al-imam al-shafi'i rahimahullah. The risala by al-imam al-shafi'i. Also, the person should try to read al-taqrib wal-irshad by Qadi Abi al-Tayyib, Qadi Abi al-Tayyib, al-taqrib wal-irshad. The person should try to read al-mu'tamad, Abi al-Husayn, al-Basriyu. The fourth one is al-Uddah lil-Qadi Abi Ya'la. And the fifth one is Usul al-Jassas. That's the first level. This is the first level of the Ummahat books that you need to study. The second one is al-Burhan li-Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. And also the Mustasfa li-Abi Hamid al-Ghazali. That's the second level of the Ummahat that you need to do Mutala'a of. The third one is the Ihkam al-Ahkam by Al-Amidi rahimahullah. And also the Mahsul by Al-Razi. After that, you go to the fourth level of the Ummahat that you do Mutala'a of is Al-Minhaj and the Mukhtasar al-Hajib and then the Jam' al-Jawami'. The Talib Ilm should do Tamakkun and really, really, really study the Kitab Jam' al-Jawami'. After you finish those four levels and you went through those four levels in Mutala'a reading, the person should go for the Jawami', these comprehensive books which are called Kutub al-Tahqiq fi al-Usul. These books are Tahqiq, meaning the person would be able to say that this view is stronger or this opinion is stronger in Qawa'id al-Usuliyya once he has studied these three books. The first one is Al-Bahr al-Muhit by Zarkashi. And the second one is Kashf al-Asrar an Usul al-Bazdawi by Abdul Aziz al-Bukhari. And the third one is Sharh al-Kawkab al-Munir by Ibn Najjar al-Hanbali rahimahullah. Once you read those three books, you have reached Darajat al-Tahqiq fi al-Usul. You have now reached the Darajat al-Tahqiq fi al-Usul. There's nothing really left for you to now go over. You've really taken the gist of what Usul al-Fiqh is. That's the first sciences from the 10 sciences a person needs to know if he wants to ground himself ala madhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i. And as you can see, this shows us that knowledge is, it's more than what we think. It requires sabr wal-musabara. And it requires patience and it requires determinations. It's not going to the Google search, taking information from there and then thinking to yourself that you've understood. The second, which is Al-Furu' Al-Fiqhiyyah. Al-Furu' Al-Fiqhiyyah from the 10. I'm going to leave Al-Furu' Al-Fiqhiyyah to the end. Because I want to make that one a discussion itself. I want to go through the books of the Furu' al-Fiqhiyyah, how they're written, where they were originally taken from, and the martaba and the order in which it came through. And then I will talk about which of those books does a person needs to study, and then I will talk about those which the person needs to do mutala'a of, meaning he or she should read. Okay? That he or she should read. So let's put the Furu' al-Fiqhiyyah ala madhhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i, let's put that on pause for now. And let's go into the third point, which is ilm al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah. Ilm al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah. Al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah, as we said before, the person should try to, we've already explained what ilm al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah is, you should know by now. Ilm al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah, the person should try to, inshallah ta'ala, focus on three books. These three books will suffice you. And all three of them, you should try to, inshallah ta'ala, or the first two, you should study it with a sheikh. The first two, you should study with a sheikh. And a teacher should go over it with you. The first one is, إضاح القواعد الفقهية لطلاب المدرسة الصولتية. إضاح القواعد الفقهية لطلاب المدرسة الصولتية. This kitab is written by Abdullah ibn Sa'id al-Lahji, al-Hadrami, al-Shihawiyu, رحمه الله رحمة الواسعة. He was a teacher, he was a مدرس إلى المدرسة الصولتية في مكة المكرمة. He used to teach them. And he authored this book. This كتاب is القواعد الفقهية. The author wrote it. He made it two babs and a خاتمة. Two chapters and a conclusion. And he of course starts with the قواعد الفقهية الكبرى, the five القواعد الخمسة الكبرى, the five agreed upon قواعد between all of the مذاهبs. He brings those five. I would buy that kitab if I were you, and I would go over it with a sheikh. The best طبعه for that kitab is دار الضياء. دار الضياء. دار الضياء. The best publication I have seen so far on that book. The second kitab that I would say that you should try to read is الأشباه والنظائر لتاج الدين السبكي. The reason is because تاج الدين السبكي is earlier than جلال الدين السيوطي. السيوطي has الأشباه والنظائر as well. And it's the تاج, the أشباه والنظائر by جلال الدين السيوطي. So I said, there are الأشباه والنظائر by تاج الدين السبكي. And there's also الأشباه والنظائر by جلال الدين السيوطي. Suyuti of course came after, and Taj al-Din al-Subki was earlier, and the earlier the better. But the Ashbah al-Nadair by Jalaluddin al-Suyuti is the Ashbah al-Nadair which Ibn Nujaym al-Hanafi rahimahullah took from. He actually used the Ashbah al-Nadair by Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, and of course other books of the Fiqh al-Hanafi, he used it and applied it in his Al-Ashbah wal-Nadair. But he really used Jalaluddin al-Suyuti's Ashbah wal-Nadair, Ibn Nujaym al-Hanafi. And Ibn Nujaym al-Hanafi's sharah of Al-Ashbah wal-Nadair has over 140 shuruh and hawashi and etc. on it. Because Ahnaf are the biggest madhab in terms of number, and they are very strong, or they are very enthusiastic of tasnif, kitaba, writing and authorship. And it's the Ashbah al-Nadair by Suyuti, which then was made into a poetry, which is Al-Fara'id al-Bahiyya. Ala kulli hal by Ahdal. Ala kulli hal, I wouldn't advise the student to focus too much on these books of Al-Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya, because they can suffice you if you just take a little number. So if you do the إيضاح القواعد الفقهية لطلاب المدرسة الصولتية by the Sheikh عبد الله بن السعيد اللحجي الحضرمي, and then you take the الأشباه والنظائر by تاج الدين السبكي, and then after you do those two with a Sheikh, you go and you start to read the كتاب المجموع المذهب في قواعد المذهب by صلاح الدين الكيكلدي, العلاء الكيكلدي رحمه الله. He's one you do مطالعة of. And if you want the best publication for that, then you should try to get the وزارة الأوقاف of Kuwait. They published the المجموع المذهب في قواعد المذهب by العلاء الكيكلدي رحمه الله. You should buy that one. And this kitab al-majmu' al-mudhab fi qawa'id al-madhhab by Salahuddin al-Kaykaldi al-Ala'i rahimahullah al-Shafi'i, you find in it ma laysa 'inda ghayrihi, that which you will not find with others, min mabahith mati'a, some beneficial issues in them. And his kitab al-Ala'i rahimahullah wa ta'ala, because he's an imam in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he was an imam, he was a muhaddith, he knew, he was grounded in hadith, and he was also grounded in furu' al-fiqhiyya, and he was also grounded in al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, so his book came out with amazement. But a lot of people don't know it, and they don't really read it. Especially a lot of brothers who study who are Shafi'i in madhab, when it comes to qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, you see that they really jump to reading the qawa'id by Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, which is no doubt a great book. The قواعد تقرير القواعد وتحرير الفرائد والفوائد I think he called it, they go to that book. And the Qawaid of Ibn Rajab is very great and it's beneficial, لا شك ولا ريب. But he's a Hanbali in Madhab. So the Talib should try to first of all read the Kutub al-Madhab and master those. The fourth from the 10 sciences that the person needs to master is Al-Furuq al-Fiqhiyah. Al-Furuq al-Fiqhiyah, we said, is that the person learns the differences in Al-Furuq al-Fiqhiyah. The Furuq gives you malak and the ability to really know the differences that are in what? That are in fiqh issues. For example, you look at an issue, it seems similar to another one, you would know if this issue is actually the same or if it's different. And if it's different, then where is it different? Because knowing the differences allows you as an individual to give the accurate ruling. And your answers will be more accurate. The book to go through is Al-Jam'u wal-Farq by Abi Muhammad al-Juwayni. Abdullah ibn Yusuf al-Juwayni. He's the father of who? He's the father of Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. Abdul Malik ibn Abdullah ibn Yusuf al-Juwayni. The author of the Kitab al-Waraqat, this is his father. Okay, he's called Abdul Malik ibn Yusuf, ibn Abdullah ibn Yusuf al-Juwayni. And his father is called Abdullah ibn Yusuf al-Juwayni. Abu Muhammad, his father is an imam in the madhab. His father is an imam in the madhab. Rather, he was called Ashab al-Wujuh, his father, in the madhab al-Shafi'iyah. Ala kulli hal, he has a kitab called Al-Jam'u wal-Farq, where he talks about Al-Furuq al-Fiqhiyah. Abu Muhammad al-Juwayni. And the best taba'a I've seen is Dar al-Jil. Dar al-Jil. And this one is a risala ilmiyah. It was a risala. I think either it was Risala Doctorat or Risala. I think, yeah, Risala Doctorat it was. Where the author, he took Martabatu Sharaf al-Ula in it. He took Martabatu Sharaf al-Ula in it. So that's the best publication for it so far. And it's in two volumes. I think that inshallah ta'ala should be what the student of knowledge buys. The fifth science is Takhrij al-Furu'i ala al-Usul. Takhrij al-Furu'i. الأصول. And we already mentioned what it means, تخريج الفروع على الأصول. تخريج الفروع على الأصول is, we said, it's the relationship between أصل المذهب, the foundation of the madhab, and the مسألة, the فروع that you have here. What is the relationship between it? This is called تخريج الفروع على الأصول. The student at this particular point, he should buy the Kitab al-Tamhidu fi Takhrij al-Furu'i ala al-Usul by al-Isnawi or al-Asnawi. I've seen both ways it being said. Some people they say al-Isnawi and some they say al-Asnawi. And I haven't come to the conclusion of which one is the right way of saying it or if they both can be said, but I've seen it both being said. Al-Isnawi or al-Asnawi, he has a Kitab called al-Tamhid في تخريج الفروع على الأصول. It's called التمهيد في تخريج الفروع على الأصول. A student should study that with a teacher. And a teacher should go through with him. Once a teacher has taught you that, you should then go and read by yourself. You should go and read by yourself مفتاح الوصول إلى بناء الفروع على الأصول by تلمسان المالكي. And the best تحقيق on that one is the تحقيق of محمد علي الفركوس. حفظه الله تعالى شيخ محمد بن علي الفركوس الجزائري the great شيخ the great scholar of Algeria شيخ محمد علي الفركوس he's a حقيقة he's an أصولي فقيه والله he's an أصولي he has a تحقيق on the كتاب and mashallah he has فوائد لطيفة on it so I definitely would say that a student of the madhab of Imam Shafi'i should try to read that because they're in it mabahith that are for madhab Imam Shafi'i. ولذلك you'll always find the irtibat between those two, Imam Shafi'i and Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala, there are connections between the two. ولذلك Abdullah ibn Hajj al-Shanqiti rahimahullah, his kitab Maraq al-Su'ud لمبتغي الرقي والسعود was originally taken from the Kitab Kawkab al-Sati' So it was originally taken from the Kitab Kawkab al-Sati' or either the Jabr al-Jawami'. Okay? That's where it was taken. Then the Jabr al-Jawami' has nothing, poetry made out of it. One of the nothings that were made out of it is the Kawkab al-Sati' by Suyuti. And also, Abdullah ibn Hajj al-Shaqiti, he done nothing of Jabr al-Jawami' as well. But the Jabr al-Jawami' is by Tajuddin al-Subki, and Tajuddin al-Subki is a Shafi'i. And Suyuti is a Shafi'i. But Abdullah ibn Hajj al-Shaqiti, what he did was he took the Kitab Jabr al-Jawami' and he wrote it in poetry form with the what? With the Aqwal al-Madhab al-Maliki, according to the Madhab of the A'immat al-Malikiyya. So it's not wrong to sometimes read these other books in other sciences to take out of it your own madhab, such as what is here now, Maftah al-Wusul ila Bina' al-Furu' al-Wusul. But with the condition that the person first of all reads with a sheikh and studies with a sheikh the At-Tamheed fi Takhrij al-Furu' al-Wusul by al-Isnawi am al-Asnawi. Number six science is the Tariq al-Madhab, what is known as Istilah, as I mentioned, Istilahat. And before I said the Istilah, and then I mentioned the Takhrij al-Furu' al-Wusul, but now I did it back and forth. I'm a back and front. I'm back to front. The best book I can advise you when it comes to Tariq al-Madhab and the Istilahat of the Madhab, and who are the Mu'tamideen, who are the people who relied on within the Madhab, and also the Fiqh al-Ibarat, the Ibarat in the Madhab that are used. And matters, the book that I can advise you is a kitab that haqiqatan I loved it, I benefited a lot from it, is the kitab written by Akram al-Qawasili. It's called Al-Madkhal ila Dirasati Madhab al-Shafi'i. It's called Al-Madkhal ila Dirasati al-Madhab al-Shafi'i. This kitab is very good. It gives you a good understanding about Tariq al-Madhab, the history of the Madhab and the stages that it went through, the formation. He also talks about the istilahat and the terminologies that are used within the madhab. He talks about who are the mu'tamideen, who are the people who are relying on within the madhab. He talks about that. He also talks about fiqh al-ibarat, some of the terms that were used by the scholars within the madhab, and you know, ibarat and issues like that. He talks about it, which is good. You'll benefit a lot from that. There's a kitab which is still makhtud, it's not matbu', it's called Tarshih al-Tawshih. It's called Tarshih al-Tawshih. And it's written by al-Subki. Okay? It's written by Tajuddin al-Subki rahimahullah ta'ala. It has within it a fiqh ibarat, ibarat al-madhab, which you tell mabhath in there. And if you go on the internet, you actually find the Makhtut on one of the websites that I downloaded it from. It's very good. There's a mabhat in which he talks about fiqh ibarat al-madhab. A person can read, and he has tatbiqat nafisa, to be honest. But the book ilal-an, it's Makhtut, and it requires haqiqatan somebody to come and to do tahqiq of the book. Also, if you look at the muqaddima of the kitab Nihayatul Matlab fi Dirayatil Madhab by Abi Ma'ali al-Duwaini, the muqaddima by Dr. Abdul Azim al-Deeb, in the beginning, he also has in there some historical development or formation of the madhab. He mentions it there. He talks about the terminologies that are used within the madhab and etc. Also, if you buy the kitab Al-Fawaid al-Makkiyya by Alawi al-Saqaf rahimahullah ta'ala, a person can benefit from that. There are other books that are also beneficial that a person can benefit from. Now we're going to go into the seventh one that a person should look into. Now we're going to go into the seventh science that a person should study and learn if he wants to be grounded in the madhab of Imam al-Shafi'i. And that is Al-Jadal. Al-Jadal. Jadal, as we mentioned before, by studying Jadal, the person, he learns or he benefits in Jadal the malak, the ability of iqamat al-hujjah, to establish the evidences, warad al-shubah, and to also repel and dismiss and dispel doubts that are brought forward. Jadal, that's what it benefits you. And if a person studies jadal, that's what he will be able to do. The book that I would advise is the Al-Ba'una fil Jadal by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. That's very beneficial. And the Sheikh himself tried to summarize. He tried to summarize Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, and he tried to make it Al-Mulakhas fil Jadal, lakin it is makhtoot, which inshallah ta'ala yutba'u qareeban inshallah ta'ala. Hopefully it's going to be published soon. It's been worked on as a Risala Jami'a Ilmiya. I think doctorate has been worked on. So I hope it will be published soon, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. I hope it will be published, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Lakin al-ma'una fi al-jadal by Ishaq al-Shirazi is very good. And it's good because he ala tariqat al-mutaqaddimin. It's on the way of the early generation of the fuqaha al-shafi'iyya. The eighth science is al-khilafiyyat. And I already mentioned that the khilafiyyat is what we call today fiqh al-muqaran. We call it today fiqh al-muqaran, comparative fiqh. Three books are what I would advise a person to look at. Number one is Ad-Durratul Mudiyyah fi ma waqa'a fihi al-khilaf bayna al-shafi'iyyah wal-hanafiyyah. It's written by Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni. The second book is Al-Istilam fi al-khilaf bayna al-imamayn al-shafi'i wa Abi Hanifa li Abi Mudhaffar al-Sam'ani. And the third one is النكت في الخلافيات لأبي إسحاق الشيرازي. So the first one is written by Abi Ma'ali al-Juwayni, and the second one is written by Abu Mudhaffar al-Sam'ani. Abu Mudhaffar al-Sam'ani was an imam in the Hanafi madhhab. For 30 years he was a Hanafi, and then he left Hanafiya and he became a Shafi'i for 20 years. And so he wrote a book which he called it Al-Istilam في الخلاف بين الإمامين الشافعي وأبي حنيفة. And Imam Abu Mudhaffar al-Sam'ani, he has tariqa ajiba in bringing points forward, especially if you read his kitab Al-Qawati' al-Adillah, you see that he has nafas fi usul al-fiqh, grounded. And you can see his understanding of madhhab al-hanafiyya is amazing. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. The ninth science that the student should definitely try to read and study is al-fatawa wa-tanzeel. And this is, of course, not something that a person, a student of knowledge, will study with a sheikh. This one is mutala'ah. Student reads it himself. And he goes over it himself. And he studies it alone, on his free time. And the books that I would advise a student to read, fatawa, and you learn the verdicts that are given and how they've been applied on incidents and situations. I would say read the fatawa al-Qadi al-Husayn, Fatawa al-Qadi al-Husayn, and Fatawa al-Baghawi, and the Fatawa of Ibn Salah, and the Fatawa of Imam al-Nawi, and the Fatawa of Subki, and the Fatawa of Bulqaymi and Bulqini, and the Fatawa of Al-Haytami, and the Fatawa of Shihab al-Ramli, rahimahullah. These Fatawa are very good. You learn a lot of fiqh from it, and he teaches you how to apply on issues and situations. The tenth science that a student should look into is Tabaqat al-Ashab. Tabaqat al-Ashab is the levels of the imams of the madhab, and this will benefit you when it comes to Masail al-Tarjih. If you want to strengthen the views of the scholars, and who do you give precedence to over who? Wal-Dalika al-Imam al-Nawawi in his the Muqaddimah of his kitab, Tahdib al-Asma' wal-Lughat, when he talks about the importance of knowing the tarajim of the scholars, the biography of the scholars, he mentions that one of the benefits of learning the scholars and their biography is that when they oppose one another and they differ on issues, you would know who do you want to put forward and whose speech you give precedence to over who. He mentions that, rahimahullah ta'ala, because his kitab, Tahdib al-Asma' wal-Lughat, as you can see from the name, it deals with two things. The first thing is tarajim, biography of scholars and their names and how it's pronounced and how it's written. And it's also got tarajim, lughat, which is, it's like a qamus. It has the definitions of words. The books that you should try to read, or the book that you should truly give a lot of importance to, is Subki's Kitab, Tabaqat al-Shafi'iyyah al-Kubra. If you've read that, that would be good enough for you. But if you have free time to add more onto it, then try to read Ibn Hidayatullah al-Husayni, his Tabaqat al-Shafi'iyyah. And also the Tabaqat al-Shafi'iyyah by Abdullah al-Shaqawi. Lakin, as I said, that the Tabaqat of al-Shafi'iyyah al-Kubra by Tajuddin al-Subki rahimahullah will suffice you. Here, the student of knowledge has finished the barnamij, the program for ad-dirasa, to study the madhab. Those are the 10 sciences. When those 10 brothers, you study them, as we mentioned before, and you learn those 10, you now deserve to be called Shafi'iyul, or you now deserve to be said about Sahibu Nafasin Shafi'i. You are grounded within the madhab. And as I said to you before, this is not unique for the Shafi'i madhab alone. It's something that can be said about the other madhahibs. It's something that can be said about the other madhahibs. Inshallah ta'ala, in tomorrow's session, I want to speak about bi-idhnillahi al-kareem al-furu' al-fiqhiyah, which I haven't touched on. I only mentioned 9. Al-furu' al-fiqhiyah is missing from me. What I want to do, inshallah ta'ala, is I want to give you the tasalsul ba'd kutub al-madhab. I want to speak about some of the madhab books that are written, the order that they were written in, how they came out from each other. And I will also, inshallah ta'ala, at that point, I will mention the tarjama and the biography of Imam Shafi'i. And I'll also mention the tarjama, but in a summarized manner, of Imam Nawawi. I will do that, inshallah ta'ala. And I'll also mention a summarized tarjama of the Imam Rafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala. And then, inshallah ta'ala, that will be the conclusion of our session into the introduction of Al-Madhab Al-Shafi'i, how to study it and how to learn it. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.